G'day guys, we've got an economics problem for you today. We've got to consider a too good Stone-Geary utility function U of A B, which is given here. And from that, we have to derive the Marshallian demand functions for both good A and good B. So before we start, let's just talk a little bit about what this Stone-Geary utility function is and how is it different from any other type of utility function which we may have already seen. So the Stone-Geary utility function is often used to model problems which involve subsidence levels of consumptions. In these cases, a certain minimum level of goods need to be consumed irrespective of its price or the income of the consumer. For example, these will be items such as food, water, and shelter. If oxygen was for sale, this would be part of subsidence consumption. So basically what we're going to be doing as a consumer is we'll be setting aside a portion of our income for the consumption of these goods before we then allocate the rest of our income to the purchase of other goods. So let's get started. So we're going to need to set up a fairly standard utility maximization problem where we have to maximize this Stone-Geary utility function given a particular income constraint. But before we do that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to rewrite this so it's going to make it easier for me to do the differentials later on. So rather than writing the utility function in terms of A and B like this, I'm going to take the natural log of each side. So and I'm going to represent this rather than having a capital U, I'm just going to represent it with a lowercase u. Now u of A and B is going to be equal to the natural log of the regular function, which when we rewrite this using natural logs, it's going to be equal to gamma times the natural log of A minus alpha plus 1 minus gamma times the natural log of B subtract beta. So what we need to do, guys, is our utility maximization problem is we have to maximize lowercase u of AB subject to an income constraint where we have the consumer's income is going to be totally spent on the purchase of these two goods. So that's going to be the price of A times the amount of A that we're going to buy plus the price of B times the amount of B that we're going to buy. Great. So our resulting Lagrangian function L is going to be given by our objective function plus our Lagrangian multiplier multiplied by our constraint. Cool. Now following the Lagrangian, we have to set our first order conditions for our optimization problem. And basically what they are is that the partial derivative of our Lagrangian with respect to goods A and B as well as the partial derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to its multiplier have to all be equal to zero. Great. So from here, guys, using a fair bit of algebra, we can use the first two first order conditions to eliminate the Lagrangian multiplier and find both A and B in terms of their allocation, which is gamma, their price, or P of A and P of B, as well as their subsidence consumption, which is alpha and beta. So let's get to that. So to start with, guys, what I'm going to do is I'm going to rearrange both the partial derivatives with respect to A and B. So rather than having zero on one side, we've got the Lagrangian multiplier times the price of A on the right-hand side, as well as the Lagrangian multiplier and the price of B on the right-hand side of both of these equations. And from here, guys, to eliminate lambda or the Lagrangian multiplier, I'm going to divide the Lagrangian multiplier times the price of A by the Lagrangian multiplier times the price of B. Now, rather than have this fraction divided by this fraction, I'm going to get this fraction and multiply it by the reciprocal of this fraction. And from here, guys, it's quite easy to see that the Lagrangian multipliers will cancel each other out. And we're going to have the price of A on the price of B equal to the allocation times good B take its subsistence consumption over good A subtract its subsistence consumption multiplied by 1 take the allocation. So if you can bear with me, guys, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the price of B from the left and multiply it by the right-hand side, as well as take the denominator from the right-hand side and multiply it by the price of A on the left-hand side. Great. And from here, guys, what I can do is I can, it's just a few quick algebraic steps, but then I can rearrange this equation so we have A equals as well as B equals. Cool. So you can see, guys, that we've got this consumption of good A that is influenced both positively by the price of good B, inversely by the price of good A, but it also has this amount of consumption here that is not related at all to the price of A and B. So it's quite sort of interesting to see, or it's easy to see, that this alpha and beta term in each of these equations is the subsistence consumption, or the consumption of good A and B, which we have to buy regardless of the price because we need it to survive. Because Marshallian demand functions are the specification of what consumers would buy at every price and wealth situation or income situation, we need to substitute both of these parameters we've just found into the third first order condition. So once we've done that, what we'll be able to do is we will be able to have an amount of either good A or good B given a particular level of income and price of both good. So let's get to it. What I'm going to do is I'm going to substitute this parameter that I've derived for good B into good B in the third first order condition. So in effect, I'm going to substitute that into there, as well as move both the price of A and the price of B to the left-hand side. Now, rather than writing good B here, I'm going to substitute in this parameter. Cool. So the first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to multiply the price of B into this bracket, and hopefully you will see that the price of B in the fraction will cancel out. Cool. And from here, guys, what I've done is I've taken the price of B and the subsistence allocation of good B, i.e. beta, to the left-hand side, as well as rearranged this fraction here to make it easier for me to see how I was going to multiply the price of A into this first bracket. Once I'd done that, I then expanded the binomial. So I used the first inside, outside, last method, if you like. And I was left with this long equation here. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to combine my like terms. So I've got the price of A and A minus the price of A and A. So those will cancel out. And now from here, guys, I'm going to take the price of A times the subsistence allocation for good A to the left-hand side. And from here, guys, what I'm going to do is I'm going to multiply both sides of this equation by gamma over the price of A. And the reason I'm doing that is so I can basically take the price of A and gamma to the other side of the equation. So I'll just be left with the amount of good A that we're going to buy minus the sustenance allocation for good A, which is represented by alpha. So hopefully you guys will be able to see that the price of A that I've got in the denominator out the front of this bracket will cancel with both that price of A as well as that one. And this gamma that I've got will cancel with both denominators because I could factorize it and then cancel them. But hopefully you guys can see that. I don't want to do another line of working out. So if we take this up to the top, we're running out of space, but let's see if we can squeeze it in a little bit. What we'll have left is what we had on the left-hand side in this equation. But on the right-hand side, all we'll have left is good A minus the subsistence allocation for good A, which is represented by alpha. So finally, guys, to find the Marshallian demand for good A using a Stone-Geary utility function, all I'm going to do is I'm going to take this sustenance allocation for good A to the left-hand side. Then I'm going to just make it so I've got A equals. And let's put a superscript M so we know that it's the Marshallian demand. And there we have it, guys, the Marshallian demand for good A using a Stone-Geary utility function, which includes both the sustenance levels of demand for good A and good B, is equal to this function here. And by symmetry, guys, hopefully you guys by now, if you're onto this part of Marshallian demand, you should be able to understand what this symmetry equation looks like. We can find the Marshallian demand for good B is as follows. Cool, so here we have both the Marshallian demands for good A and good B. Okay guys, before I let you go, I think there's a few important points to consider that are specific to a Stone-Geary utility function, which hopefully you'll be able to take away from this derivation. So first of all, what we've come out with is Marshallian demands for both good A and good B. Now to refresh your memory, Marshallian demands are the demands for good A and B, which maximize the consumer's utility for a given income level and price level of all the goods involved. Now, the first important point to note that is unique to this Stone-Geary utility function is the first terms on the right-hand side of the equalities. What we have here in alpha and beta is the sustenance consumption of good A and good B. Now, as you can see, this is the consumption that we're going to have to maximize our utility, which is irrespective of the price of good B or the price of good A. The second point to note is this equation inside the brackets here, which looks surprisingly similar to the income equation over here, is in fact the income that the consumer has left over after we have bought the goods required to satisfy our sustenance consumption levels of good A and good B. So in effect, this is the residual income that the consumer has left over after making sure that they can survive. So the amount of good A and good B that this residual income is used to buy is, as you can see by the equation, inversely related to price of good A and the price of good B, as well as positively related to the goods importance, i.e. the allocation gamma which the consumer places on goods A and B. For instance, if gamma increases, it implies that whatever the good is now relatively more important to the consumer. So if gamma increases in this particular situation, it means good A is more important than good B. And as a result, the consumer will purchase more of good A and less of good B, all other things being equal. So I hope the video helped, guys. If it did, give it a thumbs up. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel. I put out new videos when I can. And just with regards to these kind of questions, guys, it just takes a bit of practice. You're not going to get it the first try. And if you do, you're doing a lot better than I am. And guys, also remember that if you have any problems with this video, please don't hesitate to leave them in the comments section below. And if you've got any particular problems which are causing you grief, please don't hesitate to leave them in the comments section below. I'd be happy to see if I can try and make a video on them in the future. And just a heads up, guys, I've got a PDF document which I've created the full annotations to this problem, as well as key takeaways which I feel like are important in this Stone-Geary derivation. And I've left a link to that PDF document in the description below. So again, guys, questions like this, you're not going to probably get them exactly right first time. Keep on going over them and going over them and going over them. Practice does make perfect. If you keep banging your head against the wall, eventually the wall will fall down. But as I say in most of my videos, just make sure you keep on enjoying your economics. And I'll see you again soon.